Hi everyone. I'm going to describe the rigid tapping setup I've made for the PM25 CNC conversion. Now, rigid tapping holds the tap securely in a tool holder like an end mill would be. And if you compare that to a tapping compression head, it's easy to see why rigid tapping gives better control over depth, especially as the tool begins to wear. And depth control is especially important if tapping into a blind hole. To perform rigid tapping, there needs to be synchronization between the tool height and the angular position of the tool. And that's measured by a rotary encoder on the spindle. In this case, I attached the rotary encoder to the drawbar. The rotary encoder is attached to a differential receiver, which is attached to a Pico Systems universal stepper controller, which LinuxCNC uses to coordinate all of this. The other thing that's needed is sufficient reserve capacity in the spindle motor and the axis motor. Ideally, during tapping, the spindle would maintain velocity, but any change in velocity has to be met with acceleration of the axis motor. The rest of the video is the construction of this assembly, testing using a spiral point and forming tap. Some examples of problems that occur with the system if it's run too fast, and then comparison to threadmill. Now, rigid tapping is just another tapping tool, and how I plan to use this tool is when I have parts that have a lot of small threaded holes that I can thread with a forming tap. And because it is kind of inconvenient to take this assembly off to change tools. Otherwise, especially with external threads, I'll use single point thread mills. And with popular threads like M6-1, which is the most popular thread that I make is a multi-point thread mill. If you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, let's get started.
I previously made this drawbar, and I'm taking this chance to modify the hex to be compatible with the 17 millimeter wrench that I use for my clamping kit. The hex is then turned down to receive a flex coupler, which will attach the drawbar to the rotary encoder. This isn't terribly convenient, especially when wanting to change tools, but it gives a nice, easy way to demonstrate rigid tapping. I considered also using a magnetic base encoder on the top of the spindle motor, and also using a timing belt to move the rotary encoder to the side of the head. But I'm planning to change the spindle motor, and until that's done, I don't want to do anything more complicated. The rotary encoder gives position feedback to LinuxCNC, which I use to calculate the velocity and position of the C-axis. This might be useful for operations like broaching, where you'd want to know the angular position of the spindle precisely, but you'd have to come up with a means to lock the spindle at that position. Rigid tapping feels pretty sketchy the first few times, and before recording this threading test in aluminum, I did several threading tests using wood. It takes a little bit of a leap of faith, I guess. I think this is so cool that even on do-it-yourself CNC machines, that two axes can be synchronized and controlled so precisely that rigid tapping is possible. From the side, you can see how far the spiral point tap needs to come down in order to fully tap this through hole. Besides the spiral point tap, we'll also try a forming tap. The forming taps require a different size drill bit, and they deform the metal instead of cutting the metal. More of the tap is also available for threading as well. To compensate for the threads that are not usable, you have to change the breakthrough amount in Fusion 360, and that can be parameterized by the thread pitch. The threads created by a forming tap should be stronger than those created by a cutting tap because the forming tap deforms the metal to create the threads. Also, with a forming tap, there are no chips created, so tapping to a bottom of a blind hold is more practical. Unfortunately, a forming tap requires 2 to 3 times the torque than a spiral point or spiral flute tap does. And in a high-speed belt setting, the PM25 just does not have sufficient torque at the low-end speeds. Since the height of the head is synchronized to the angular position of the tool, in the event of a spindle stall, the head will stop moving and there'll be minimal or no damage to the part. But unfortunately, recovery is quite a pain. Tech tapping may not be available in LinuxCNC, and if generating that code in Fusion 360, there are no warnings shown unless the NC editor is enabled. Other than demanding too much torque during tapping, the other type of problem that can come up is if tapping too fast. There's considerable overshoot because the head has to remain synchronized with the spindle motor as it free spins to slow down. Also, with a 2500 pulse per revolution encoder in quadrature mode at 800 RPMs, you need a very fast sampling rate. So if the spindles run too fast, even the high megahertz clock of the Pico system's controller board isn't able to fully sample the rotary encoder. 400 RPM seems to work pretty well, especially for fine pitch threads. Another gotcha is since the final upward motion after leaving the hole is uncoordinated, it isn't possible to re-thread a hole. So you only get one chance to thread a hole, and if you try to go back and thread it again, it's going to destroy the thread. We can also thread with threadmills. Here are 2 single-point and 1 multi-point threadmill. And threadmills use coordinated motion of the XYZ axes and don't require a rotary encoder on the spindle. To use a threadmill, a hole is first created to the minor diameter of the thread. Then some thread relief is created with a chamfer tool to help the head of the screw set properly. In Fusion 360, I use a 2D contour to create that chamfer and this small Python script I wrote to calculate the chamfer width. And this is what the threadmill looks like in Fusion 360. Probably every time an expensive threadmill drops down into a hole is stressful, but these tools are so cool. This hole didn't get threaded quite all the way through because Fusion 360 is looking at the tool length and bringing the bottom of that tool to the bottom of the hole. For this through hole, we need to add a slight amount of breakout, and that can be parameterized by the tool pitch. A huge advantage of threadmills is that a single threadmill can cut a variety of internal and external threads of different diameters, and if using single-point threadmills, a variety of thread pitches. But the interpolation required for threadmilling is going to always take more time than using rigid tapping with a specialized tool. I forgot the chamfer on these holes, but I hope otherwise this demo was clear. Okay, recapping, we looked at adding a spindle encoder to a CNC conversion of a PM25 milling machine, some successes and some failures of performing rigid tapping using the stock motor, and then compared rigid tapping to thread milling. I hope you find this as interesting as I do. Coordinated motion between multiple axes is a really interesting subject. If you have any suggestions or questions, please let me know. Otherwise, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.